have your Bibles, we invite you to turn to Ephesians 6, the 6th chapter of Ephesians, and we want to read verses 10 through 18. Ephesians 6, 10 through 18. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in the high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication of the saints. May God add his blessing to the reading. The following story is told by Leroy Helms about the time when he was serving in the Marines in the South Pacific during World War II. He said, shortly after we hit the beach, our armored amphibious tank took two artillery shells broadside. We immediately evacuated our disabled vehicle and darted from hole to hole toward the enemy airstrip, which we were to take. The sergeant began to check on us to make sure that we were okay. He crawled over to me and asked, "You all right, Ems?" I answered, "Yeah, I'm okay, Sarge." He looked at me and asked, "Ems, where's your helmet?" I felt the top of my head and answered, "Must be in the tank, Sarge." "Where's your duty belt?" Our duty belts carried ammunition for our rifles, a canteen of water, and a bayonet. "Must be in the tank, Sarge." "As a matter of fact, Ems, where's your rifle?" He looked at me with disgust and pity. Because of our hasty departure from the amphibious tank, I was dressed about the same way that I'd be dressed for a volleyball game. And there I was, hopping from hole to hole, from tree to tree. Now, that story reveals a lot about the modern church. And we're going to consider this morning and tonight the fight of our lives. The fight of our lives. Now, this is going to be about spiritual warfare. You know, the average Christian probably is not aware that we Christians are in war at this point. Right. We are in spiritual war. Mm-hmm. We are on a battlefield. Mm-hmm. And as a result, very few of the children of God, and I believe many are saved, some may not be, are not equipped with the proper armor, the proper equipment. We're not ready to do battle. And that's sad. Because those who are not prepared to do battle, those who are not dressed to do battle, will be defeated. Jesus says many are called, but few are chosen. Many are dropping by the wayside today, folks. Many of God's men. Many preachers that start out in the ministry dropping like flies. Many of God's people in the churches today have fallen away. They're not, they see no need for the house of God. You know, if we're going to be successful in our work for the Lord Jesus Christ, we must be ready for the battle, and we must be ready to go to war. Now, in this passage, we're given insight into the battle that we're engaged in and the weapons that we need to fight the war, to fight the battle. Now, folks, we are in the fight of our lives. And if we're to do what the Scriptures say and stand, and by the way, if you look at verses 11, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. And then notice, if you will, verse 13, take unto you the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And in verse 14, notice, if you will, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on a breastplate of righteousness. Now here in this passage, Paul reveals some aspects of the battle in which we find ourselves. Now let's notice, if you will, first of all, in any war or in any battle, there has to be an enemy. Who is the enemy in this spiritual warfare? Who is the enemy of the Christian? Notice, if you will, 10b through verse 12. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Who is the enemy of the Christian? His name is Satan. His name is the devil. And his name there, it's a word that means slanderer or accuser. Now we get our word diabolical from that. Now Mr. Hugo Chavez called George Bush El Diablo. And Mr. Chavez may be seeing Mr. Diablo today, but anyway, I just thought that interesting. You know, ever since the devil first appeared on the pages of Scripture, he's been in the business of lying, he's been in the business of slandering and accusing the people of God. Now, we won't read the text, but if you go back to the third chapter of Genesis there, he appeared in the form of a serpent. And there he tricked Eve, the mother of all humanity, into eating there the fruit that God told she and Adam not to eat. He said, if you eat this fruit and of the knowledge of the tree of good and evil, you shall surely die. Well, the devil come upon her and said, well, Eve, why don't you eat that fruit? And she said, well, God told us not to. He said, we'd die if we did. Ah, don't pay any attention to that. He really didn't mean what he said. Why, if you, he's trying to keep something from you. If you eat that fruit, you will become as gods. So she ate the fruit, as the old saying is, she ate my house and home. God had to expel them from the garden. Then you go to the book of Job, first couple of chapters, having to do with human suffering. And according there to the text, Satan has access to the throne room of God. So he was there one day. Say, well, consider your servant Job down there. You've really blessed him. You've given him a lot of money. You've prospered him with lands, with big family and all of that. And he says, I guarantee you one thing, if he didn't have all of that, he would curse your name and die. Well, God said, I don't think he would, Satan, but we'll have a little wager. And God allowed Satan to do everything that he could, bold suffering, and lost his family, lost his holdings, lost everything. He pulled back the hedge and allowed Satan to have so much of Job. God does that occasionally. Paul, there about the thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to Bethany, you know, I believe he'll allow the devil into our lives more so than common, maybe to buffet us. Why would he do that? Well, to keep us humble, you know, or, you know, to keep us from getting too much into our comfort zone. But he allowed the devil to have his way at Job. He could do anything that he wanted to except to kill. Now we see our enemy's nature there, as we read in verses 11 and 12. And these two verses tell us two things that we need to keep in mind concerning the enemy. First of all, notice if you will, there in verse 11, he is a shrewd enemy. The word wiles there in verse 11, we get our English word method. And it means craftiness and trickery. Well, in Ephesians 4:14, it's translated to lie in wait. I'll give you a little illustration of that. I'm not much of a hunter, but I took care of my neighbor's animals while she went on a cruise, fed the chickens and fed and watered the rats, pretty little white rats. Well, I noticed one of them got out one morning, and I went up there and I said, oh Lord, how did that rabbit get out of the cage? Well, I looked around and noticed it dug a hole on its way out. I said, I'll never get that rabbit. Well, I went back the next night, and sure enough, that rabbit was on the porch. And he was running around. I went up there. I said, well, I'm going to try to get him. Of course, I couldn't catch a rabbit just with my hands. So I followed. Had an old quilt there in the Jeep. So that rabbit went to the edge of the porch. I threw that quilt on it, bundled it up, and put it back in the cage. So that's sort of, I guess, what that means about lying in wait. In other words, Satan there disguises himself in order to capture his prey. And what a perfect picture of the devil. What does 1 Peter 5:8 tell us? Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is as a roaring lion walking about seeking whom. That's the way Satan operates. He goes around to God's people and he roars like a big lion and he scares us to death. But you know, he could only have so much of us as God will allow him. Now he'll come and he'll tempt us, and he'll come and he'll try to trick us up. Then in 2 Corinthians 11:14, and marvel not, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Now, we have the misconception, perhaps, of the devil is a dude painted red with a forked tail and horns on his head. That's what the pictures in the early church there, what people thought he looked like. That's not what Satan looks like. He was created Lucifer, son of the morning, and he was the most beautiful of God's creation. Not some ugly dude with a painted red with a forked tail and horns sticking out of his head. No, he's an angel of light, and he will come to us, you know, offering lies and deception. protection, but he'll sure cover them up. He'll fool you if you're not careful. And many of God's children today are being fooled. He's coming to them, making them to do things and say things and whatever that they shouldn't be doing. And many a life has been ruined. Many a couple, many a marriage broken up. Because Satan has appeared as an angel of light, saying, well, come here, take this short cover. Come here, take this woman or take this man. You're going to be a lot happier with them than you will with your own. We see that he is a spiritual enemy. Let me read that verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. You know, too often we're guilty of fighting the wrong foe or enemy. We fight each other. And that's not the true enemy. The true enemy there, as we read, in that verse there, the rulers of the darkness of this world against spiritual wickedness in high places. You know, we get at odds with our fellow believers. We fuss and we fight. We shouldn't do that. Who is the real enemy? Satan. Satan. It is a spiritual battle. Now the devil, you know, he works through people at times to get to us, cause us to stumble. But the real battle is fought on a spiritual level. We must never attack other people. Our battle is with an unseen army of spiritual enemies led by the devil himself. Now, there's an illustration for that. And since our enemy is a spiritual enemy, some might wonder how we go about knowing how to fight. Well, in World War II, General George C. Patton will help us to see this a little more clearly. Patton's troops and tanks were engaged in a successful counterattack of German forces under General Erwin Rommel. If you've ever heard of him, he was called the Desert Fox. And Patton is reported to have shouted in the thick of the battle, "I read your book, Rommel, I read your book." And that he did. In Rommel's book, Infantry Attacks, the famed Desert Fox carefully detailed his military strategy. And Patton, having read it and knowing what to expect, planned his moves accordingly. Now, as far as we know, Satan has physically not authored a book. He's probably inspired various books, but anyway, God is fully exposed to our enemy's tactics in his holy word. You want to know how to fight the devil? Study the word of God. Bathe yourself in the word of God. How did Jesus fight the devil in the wilderness? He quoted scripture. He quoted the word of God. Now, Satan offered him the kingdoms of this world and bread when he was hungry. Man shall not live by bread alone, he says. 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show thyself approved a workman that needeth not to be ashamed. That's how you fight the devil. Folks, if you try to fight him without the word of God and without the spiritual armor, you're going to lose. You will lose. I know, I've been in many a spiritual battle. Always and always God will bring those scriptures to my mind. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world, and so on and so forth. Well, moving on, we see our enemy in the fight, which is Satan. We see, secondly, our energy in the fight, Notice, if you will, there in verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Now, the Bible here makes it clear that in these verses, that our goal as Christian soldiers is that of standing or being firmly fixed. It means do not waver. You know, if we're able to stand in this day of battle, then we must not only know our enemy, but we must possess the energy there for the battle. Where do we get this energy? It's not ourselves. It's not our own strength. We're going to fall if we try to fight the enemy in our own strength. We surely will fail. We surely will fall. But we're told to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. That means we draw our strength from the power of his might. That means that we rely upon God's dominion and sovereign ability to exercise his power. We get our energy from God, from the Holy Spirit. We see the scope of our energy. When a believer's faith is in God, then the Lord's power becomes the power of the believer. You know, if the church could ever grasp that truth, we're as strong in that in which we trust. Church revolutionized the world. Today the church doesn't realize that. They don't realize that they have the power through the Holy Spirit to win the world. Let me give you a couple illustrations of that. Now, I phoned about 20 times. All over the world on mission trips and so on and so forth. And I love to fly, but I hate the preliminaries. Having to get there to go through customs and present your passport and all the pat downs and whatever. So it's really a pain, but once you get on a plane, it's the best ride of your life. Now, I don't know how a fast plane goes, 300, 400, maybe 500 miles. I can't fly. I didn't fly to work this morning, or to church, I think. I have to drive. But we can fly if we're on that plane. Don't ever try to do that. Same way in a car. I can't run 65 miles an hour. But in a car, I can. By the way, that's how preachers get tripped up a lot of times. We have that lead foot. And I had to pay for that one time. But anyway, we'll not go into that. My point is, we have the power in the form of a car and an engine and in the form of a jet plane. Same way with God. We don't have the power, but when his power is instilled in us, then we can do far more than what we expect or realize. Ephesians 3:20. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Amazing to me how the power of God works within us. How the grace of God works within us. We can do things within the will of God that we didn't think that we could do. Mark 11:22. Jesus answered and saith unto them, have faith in God. For verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Like the old woman one time prayed the prayer. There was a mountain outside of her house she wanted to move. It blocked her view. And she kept praying for God to remove that mountain. She'd get up every day and the mountain would still be there. And finally she got up and it was still there. And she said, well, I'm going to quit praying. God's not going to move this mountain. It's not the mountain that the Lord was talking about. The mountain of adversity, the obstacles that is in our way spiritually. Mark 9:23, Jesus said unto him, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. Our faith gets weak at times and we waver. John 14:12, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I shall do, he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. Now, Jesus on earth was limited. He had self-limitations upon his power. He was still God, but he was in the flesh. And he was limited with time. He could only get so much done in terms of the 33 and a half years he had here. Then the strength of our energy. It enables us to stand, 1 Corinthians 15:58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast and movable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. You know, sometimes we probably think that our battles and everything is in vain. But it's not. There will come a day when we face the Lord. And hear it say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Paul said, I have fought the fight. I have kept the faith. I finish my course. God's power will be our power, and we will be able to stand for him in the day of battle. Not too many are standing. Many have fallen by the wayside. I'll be honest, I've been tempted to fall. I've been tempted to run. But God said, I need those who will stand. Who will stand. Let me close with this illustration. During the Civil War, the war between the states, writes Gary Reading, a Union soldier from Ohio was shot in the arm during the Battle of Shiloh. And his captain saw he was wounded and barked an order. Give me your gun, private, and get to the rear. The private handed over his rifle and ran toward the north seeking safety. But after covering 200 or 300 yards, he came upon another skirmish. Then he ran to the east and into another part of the battle. Then he ran west and encountered more fighting there. Finally, he ran back to the front line shouting, give me back my gun, Captain. There ain't no rear to this battle. And when it comes to spiritual warfare, they ain't no rear. Man, you try to run one place and run out of one battle, and you run right into the next. You may as well stand and fight. In 2 Samuel 23, 11 and 12, we'll close with that. And after him was Shammah, the son of Agi the Harite. And the Philistines were gathered together into a troop where there was a piece of ground full of Gentiles. And the people fled from the Philistines, but he stood in the midst of the ground and defended it and slew the Philistines, and the Lord brought a great victory. Sometimes, folks, all we can do is fight, stand and fight. We're tempted to run. We're tempted to lay our armor down. But we need to stand and fight. Well, this morning we've considered our enemy in the fight, our energy in the fight. Tonight we want to take up with our equipment in the fight.